So let's talk about private windows in Safari. They're also called private windows in Firefox, and they're called incognito windows in Chrome. So when you create a new private window, it's like you're creating a separate browser instance from your main one. For instance, if I'm logged into a website, like here I'm logged into Twitter, I'll see a bunch of special controls because I'm logged in as MacMost and I'm viewing my own page. If I wanted to see what this looked like to somebody else, I would have to log out and then go back to this page. Or I could open up a new private window. And in that private window, I can go to the same page, and even though I'm logged in here, I'm logged out over here. So that's very useful. You can use that for viewing your own website, for instance, and see what other people see when they go to your own website. In addition, you can do a second login. So I can log in as another account, another Twitter account here, or maybe if you manage a Facebook page for somebody, or you know, you have multiple users on your website, that kind of thing. You can log in as a second user in a private window. You can actually do a third and fourth and fifth user too. You can just keep opening private windows. They're all separate. They have separate website data, separate cookies. So it's going to be like you're logged in using a completely different browser. This is also useful if you're about to give a presentation on your laptop, right? You don't want to give a presentation and then end up going to a website and seeing yourself as being logged in, or maybe doing a search and you see suggestions based on previous searches and things like that. It's always useful to open up a second window, a private window, just with Shift Command N. Get that open in the background before you give your presentation. That way when you switch to Safari, you are then using a private window and it doesn't have all the cookies and website data as your regular main window in Safari. Now when you search, say, Google, you're going to get search results that are based on your search term but also your previous search history, especially if you're logged in using, say, Gmail or Google Drive or something. You can see here I'm not logged in, but if I was logged in, it would look at my past history and try to figure out maybe what to show me in my search results. But if I do a new private window, then I could search Google and it's like I'm not logged in at all and it doesn't have any kind of cookies or anything saved, so I'm going to get more of a pure search. So searching for yourself or your website or something like that, or even doing research, you're going to get a much better result if you do a private browsing window. And this is even more true for something like Amazon, right? If you're logged into Amazon in the main window, you're going to get search results based on your previous buying habits and things like that. Not only that, but if you search for something in Amazon, you're then going to get future search results altered by the search you just did. So if you want to do a pure search in Amazon, you can do it in a private browsing window, separate, without having to log out of Amazon to do that. And also, it's the same kind of thing if you're searching, say you're going to do a Google search, and you're just going to do it for something, it's just on a whim. Like you want to see, hey, you know, what does it cost to fly to Australia? Or what exactly does like a Toyota Avalon cost or something? You know, you do those searches, you're going to get hit with ads for flights and for cars for the foreseeable future. But if you do it in a private browsing window, all that stuff is saved into cookies, and those cookies get deleted when you close the private browsing window, and you won't get bothered with those alterations to your searches and your ads. Now another thing that private browsing does is it doesn't add to your history. So here I've got history, all, you know, all the sites I've been to. And if I were to do a search here, like say I was going to search for a job while at my current job, or I was going to try to surprise my spouse with a trip to Italy next year and I was going to do a bunch of searches for research for that, that's all going to show up in history. You may not want that. But if you do a private browsing window and you do a search, then it's not going to show up. So here I can even you know, click on some of this stuff and it doesn't show up in my history. It's not saving it because I'm in private browsing mode. The same reason that you want to use private browsing when you're using somebody else's PC, like a friend's PC or maybe one in a public place, right? You don't want to use it for anything you log on to anyway. But if you want to kill some time by, you know, just doing some random searches or reading some news stories, doing a private browsing window is a great way to do it. You're not adding to their search history and you're not leaving a trail behind you. Here's a use for private browsing that I have mixed feelings about. Say you're at a site that has a soft paywall. Soft paywall means that you can view a certain number of articles per month and then you can't view anymore. You get hit with something like this. You can get around that in many cases by creating a new private window pasting in the same URL to the article you wanted to read, and it will load up just fine because it sees this as completely unrelated to this window, right? There's no the cookie that's saved here that's saying, oh, you've viewed 5 articles this month is nowhere to be found here. So it looks like you're a new user and now you can read that article. I have mixed feelings because if a website wants to limit access and put a paywall up, then they should be able to. But in a lot of cases for news articles, sometimes it's the only news source and there's an important alert that affects your safety or security and you want to see what the information is, and that's behind the paywall. I'm not sure that that's the right thing to do. And other times the information behind a paywall isn't actually unique. For instance, a lot of times it's just an Associated Press article that's available for free everywhere else. So if you were to actually pay, then you would go and see that, hey, wait a minute, I could have just read this article for free elsewhere. So, you know, you could kind of make your own judgment and see whether or not you want to use private browsing for that reason.